Dear attendees, welcome back to the first FibonTech International Congress. We are now starting session four, the last session of this first day of Congress. We will proceed now with the presentations. First, the presentation from Ana Sofia Rodrigues, from Universidade da Beira Interior, followed by Pedro Correia, from Instituto Politécnico de Beja, Luís Madeira, also from Instituto Politécnico de Beja, Lúcio Gomes, from Universidade do Porto, Teresa Borralho, from Instituto Politécnico de Beja, and the last one, Carla Santos, from Universidade do Porto. So, we will start now with the presentations.
Hello, my presentation is about diclofenac photodegradation under visible light with LABAFETIO3 perovskites. Perovskites are a class of compounds with the general formula ABX3, frequently ABO3. Perovskites are characterized by their flexible chemical composition, structural stability and elemental abundance. Approximately 90% of the periodic table metal elements can be accommodated in the perovskite structure. Due to this structure flexibility, perovskite type metal oxides are being increasingly investigated in various areas, namely as photocatalysts for water decontamination. Photocatalysts are semiconductors with bandgap energy between 1.4 and 3.8 electrovolts, being activated by visible light for He greater 3 electrovolts. Perovskite's optical properties may be changed by doping. It is important to develop the photocatalysts activated by solar energy. Diclofenac is a pharmaceutical compound of great environmental concern due to its occurrence and fate. It was already detected in reservoirs of drinking water. It can be removed from the effluents by many ways. The objective was synthesize perovskite of this family. Test the prepared perovskites as photocatalysts for the degradation of synthetic solutions of diclofenac and evaluate the influence of the chemical composition and of the preparation method on the perovskite photocatalytic activity. Perovskites were synthesized by the ceramic method. BATIO3 and BAFEO3 were also synthesized by polymerization method. All the synthesized perovskites were characterized. Photocatalytic degradation assays were performed in a setup that allows simultaneous assays. Diclofenac degradation was monitored by UV visible absorption spectrometry. For the different synthesized perovskites, bandgap energies were determined. Both BATIO3 present cubic symmetry in a PM3M space group. BATIO3, prepared by polymerization method, evidence an orthorhombic secondary phase, probably due to the lower synthesis temperature. BAFEO3MC presents a predominant hexagonal structure, but BAFEO3PC has a predominance of a cubic structure, although both with traces of secondary phases. Only one perovskite has a monoclinic structure. BAFE0.8TI0.203 and BAFE0.6 TI0.403 have hexagonal structure, but a new phase can be detected. For BATIO3, it seems that the preparation method does not to have any influence on the unit cell. For BAFEO3, the crystallite size changed significantly with the preparation method. The bandgap energy gives us the information for use in photocatalytic assays. However, the existence of secondary phase forming heterostructures. It was found that 20% substitution of BA by LA causes an increase in the photocatalytic activity and presents the best result. Result shows that perovskites of this family can be utilized as visible light-driven photocatalysts for deep Kovnack degradation. The best removal rates were attained with LA0.2 BA0.8TiO3 prepared by the ceramic method and with BAFEO3 prepared by the complex polymerization method. The results evidence that synthetized perovskites are promising for use with natural sunlight for depuration of natural waters. And thank you for your attention.
Hello, thanks you, Mr. Sherman. First, I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to present. This work was shared out at the Polytechnic Institute of Belgium. My name is Pedro Correa. I'm the PhD student. My presentation is about photoremediation of bore from was water in the vertical flow constituted wet wetland. So I have divided my presentation in six parts. Then, firstly, I explained for you what is the problem associated with bore pollutions. Second part, what is the objective of this work. Third part, many process to was water. 3, finally, I will present for you one special process of was water treatment that involves plants. Four point continuations of the material and methods. 50 points resultant and discussions included biomass and was water. The last point is conclusions. The problem. The first questions: what is bore? The bore is metalloid, is not found, is a free element in the natura. Second questions: where is the used bore? Born can be from many activities, for example, using of the agrochemicals, these pictures, cleaning products, the next pictures, and mining operations. Cause contaminations of the aquatic environment. Bore is the relatively soluble in the water, and its excesses in the aquatic habitats can cause toxicity of the crops and plants, contaminations in soil or sediments, reproductive risks, and the problems in the cardiovasculars, coronary, and the nervous systems. Some treatments, methods used to remove from wastewater are membrane process, ion exchange, adsorption. But they are expensive and require costly equipment or chemicals. That's why constituted wetlands have been used to remove pollutants for contaminated water due to their samples, operations, eco-friendly properties, and cost effectiveness. Objective number one is the possibility to bore removal and its removal efficiency in the vertical flow. Objective number two, study the tolerance or sensitivity of vetiver to different concentrations. Pilot plants constitute wetland. The wetland planted with vetiver was using surface feed by equidistant sprinklers with synthetic wastewater prepare with boric acid and micronutrients dissolved with tap water. The picture on the left is the schematics of the system. The picture of the right is the vetiver plant. Operational conditions applied. In the study, two variations of bore concentrations, 15 and 30 milligrams per liter, and constant hydraulic load of the around 91 liter meter square per day. System monitoring and analytical methods. Some of parameters analyzed were is a temperature, soil and air, flow rate in inlet and outlet, pH, DO, EH, and B or boron. Basis of toxic singles. The nutrients and 3 meter in leaves of vetiver. Discussion on the results. Leaf grow. This graphic shows the evolutions of plants in function of concentrations. There was the small grow in the freestyle weed, the most concentrations. After this trial, because plant should leave coring, more concentration in the fluent decrease to 15 milligrams per liter. Leaves grow was a very good without signals of yawling and coring. signs of toxicity, leaves, sclerosis, and stop grow there were detected at the yeasted bore concentrations. Can be seen in the present pictures, these evaluations, and the chlorosis. Results and discussions, leaves, biomass, compositions. It is possible to observe that magnesium and phosphorus concentrations that's by about of compared to Beningen of the detrial low for low concentrations, all mineral element increased their concentrations in the leaves, in the leaves. Variations of the DO in the water. DO is the dissolved oxygen. This graphic you can see do decrease it more significantly in the effluents to myron boron concentrations because phytoremediations that can consume oxygen. Variations of EH. EH is the redox potential. EH in the effluent increase without significant difference between trials. Because some reactions that change the components of the oxidation states of boron. Variations of pH in sewage water, pH decrease in the effluent. Boron removal mechanism can produce H more, so pH decreases. Results and discussions boron removal efficiency. It can be observed that when to boron mass load increase the capacity of VFCW, to boron remove decrease. Boron may interfere with the physiological structures of plants or the microorganisms present in the wetland. Conclusions. The acid concentrations caused plant leaves should chlorosis. Magnesium and phosphorus decrease in the vegetal biomass. Boron concentrations interfere with the content in the mineral elements and nutrients in plant leaves. Continuations and conclusions. Next conclusions. With two different boron concentrations was obtained with removal efficiency variant from low concentrations was 60% removal, and the most concentrations was the 26% removal. Finally, boron removal efficiency depend of the boron concentration in effluent. Thank you for your attention.
Hi, my name is Luis Madeira. The work I'm going to present is about phytoremediation remediation as a sustainable alternative for organic matter removal from slaughterhouse wastewater pre-treated by immediate on-step lime precipitation. This work is a part of my PhD. Slaughterhouse wastewater comes from washing live animals, washing facilities and equipment, washing carcasses and other activities at the slaughterhouse. These effluents are characterized by high concentrations of organic matters, nutrients such as phosphorus and nitrogen, total suspended solids, oils and fats, and microorganisms. The composition, the quantities or flow rate produced depending on the number and type of animal diet. In this way, these effluents cannot be discharged into water bodies as they can cause, for example, eutrophication, and neither can they be discharged directly into municipal wastewater treatment plant. Thus, the on-site slaughterhouse wastewater treatment is the only solution. However, the on-site slaughterhouse wastewater treatment has some disadvantages, such as produce carbon dioxide, produce sludge rich in iron, aluminium salts, with low potential for agriculture, being sent to the landfill. Treated or semi-treated water is not valid, being discharged into water search or into a municipal collector. So this solution is not environmentally sustainable. We need to rethink how wastewater should be treated and recovered. So he developed a pretreatment for slaughterhouse wastewater called immediate on-step lime precipitation. In this treatment, he used lime, that is a low-cost reagent and can be easily acquired. This process has good removals of turbidity, oils and fats, total suspended solids, phosphorus, total geodal nitrogen, biochemical oxygen demand, and chemical oxygen demand. However, this treatment is not enough to guarantee the legal specifications for irrigation disposal, requiring a more extensive treatment to reduce biochemical oxygen demand. However, so to solve this problem, we doubt that the concentrated wetland could be a solution for removing organic matter. In addition, the constructed wetland is an eco-friendly technology with low cost, low maintenance, and high efficiency in removing contaminants, if it is well designed and operated, of course. Thus, this work aims to understand the effect of the organic load applied and the bed depth of vertical flow constructed wetland planted in vetiveres isenioides on the organic matter removal from a slaughterhouse wastewater pretreated by immediate on-step lime precipitation process. We also want to know if the wetland obtained from the constructed wetland can be reused for irrigation. Finally, we want to know if the plant vetiveres isenioides tolerates the applied organic matter and the nitrogen loads. This experimental work was carried out at Polytechnic Institute of Belgium from February to April. We use a two vertical flow constructed wetlands, one with a height of 35 centimeters, designed by vertical flow constructed wetland number one, and the other with a height of the 70 centimeters, designed by vertical flow constructed wetland number two. Both vertical flow constructed wetland were planted in vetiveres isenionts and fields yield light expanded clay aggregates. Both vertical flow constructed wetlands have the same number of plants. Slaughterhouse wastewater pretreated by immediate on-step lime precipitation process was continuously distributed on the top of the vertical flow constructed wetlands. In relation to system monitoring and analytical methods, the flow rate was measured from Monday to Friday in the morning. The samples were collected in inlet and outlet of the vertical flow constructed wetland, and the parameters such as pH, dissolved oxygen, redox of potential, chemical oxygen demand, and ammonium nitrogen were characterized. Weekly, the plants were assessed visually by identifying signs of toxicity. The composition of the leaves in terms of total nitrogen, phosphorus, calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and dried matter was analyzed at the beginning and at the end of the experiments. Both vertical constructed wetlands were subjected to the same hydraulic loads, about 81 liters per square meter per day, from A to C trials. An increase in organic matter and nitrogen concentrations was applied to each vertical flow constructed wetland. For both vertical flow constructed wetlands, only four trials A and D were used diluted effluents. The vertical flow constructed wetland number two has a longer hydraulic rotation times than the vertical flow constructed wetland number one due to its greater depth. In relation to the results, we can see that for dissolved oxygen, there is no significant difference between vertical flow constructed wetlands, as well as between inlet and outlet, except for trial C. We can also observe that an increase in the organic matter and in nitrogen load applied interfered with the dissolved oxygen in the flat. Dissolved oxygen consumption is mainly due to aerobic degradation of organic matter rather than detrification. In relation to potential redox, we have the same behavior as dissolved oxygen. There is no significant difference between vertical flow constructed wetlands as well as between inlet and outlet. Increasing chemical oxygen demand and ammonium nitrogen loads applied interfered with the potential redox in effluent. Despite the observed removals of organic matter and ammonium nitrogen, no significant difference between vertical flow constructed wetlands and inlet and outlet were observed for pH, indicating that the wastewater had enough alkalinity to act as a buffer. Despite regarding COD, in this figure is possible to verify that for both vertical flow constructed wetlands, the COD removal efficiency is higher when small loads are applied. As we can see, when the COD load is higher than 200 grams per square meter per day, the COD removal did not occur in the vertical flow constructed wetland number one, and decrease in the a lot in the vertical flow constructed wetland number two, reaching values between 60% and 70%. The maximum COD load removal occurred in trails B1 and C2 for vertical flow constructed wetland number one and two respectively. Regarding the removal of ammonium nitrogen, it can be seen that ammonium removal efficiency is higher for lower loads. Contrary to what would be expected, the removal of ammonium in the vertical flow constructed wetlands was observed in presence of large of amounts of organic matter and in low concentrations of dissolved oxygen in the influent. It was also observed that the removal of ammonia did not occur in the vertical flow constructed wetland number one, but in vertical flow constructed wetland number two, with a removal percentage of 58%. No signs of toxicity and no symptoms of micronutrient deficiency were detected in the plant by visual inspection. Since the trials were carried out between February and April, the plants did not grow much. Regarding the composition of leaf biomass, an increase in the concentration of calcium, potassium, and total nitrogen in the leaves was observed for both vertical flow constructed wetlands after the end of the experiment. This increase was greater in the vertical flow constructed wetlands number two. So conclusions, we can be concluded that vertical flow constructed wetland depth has a significant influence on the removal of organic matter and ammonia nitrogen, with a greater removal for high bed depth. For organic loads apply up to 9 grams per square per meter per day, it is possible to obtain COD concentrations of 33 milligrams per liter and 17.4 milligrams per liter for the lowest and the highest depth vertical flow constructed wetland, respectively, which allows its reuse in the irrigation. It is very important to continue this work to understand how ammonium nitrogen is removed in the presence of high organic matter and small amounts of dissolved oxygen in the influent. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Lucio Gomes. The work that I'm going to show today is the tubing-tube photo catalyst membrane reactor for the removal of 19 contaminants of emerging concern, selecting no water purge from secondary treated urban wastewater. Urban wastewater treatment plants are pointed among the main source for the spread of contaminants of emerging concern into the environment. CEC includes a wide range of chemicals and most treatment were not designed to remove low levels of these contaminants, being only partially effective in the degradation. Thus, it is important to develop innovative technology for advanced oxidation process capable of degrading contaminants in wastewater treatment plants. The system we will use is tubing-tube membrane photoreactor. This reactor has been shown to be the saturated change operating conditions and efficient in other studies with CEC. In the present work, it is intended to use this innovative technology, testing the removal of CEC at very low concentrations from secondary treated urban wastewater, comparing different processes to improve the performance of the system. Treatment tests using the reactor system were carried out with H desmineralized water or real wastewater after secondary treatment. This is the list of the 19 contaminants selected under no water purge. The effluent to be treated is phosphate with the 10 micrograms per liter of each contaminant. In addition to comparing the treatment performance between different combination of process, the application of promising new photocatalyst silver molybdate was evaluated. The initial tests were carried out with desmineralized water is continuous mode at a flow rate of 3 liters per hour, with a hydraulic residence time of 6.1 seconds on the UVC radiation, dosing the selected oxidant, hydrogen peroxide or presulfates. Subsequently, use the best oxidant catalyst in combination or real wastewater optimization studio were carried out with partial recirculation. Using this mineralized water, photolysis of the CEC was negative. The photocatalytic tests, titanium and silver molybdate, were slightly better than the UVC photolysis. Experiments with the addition of oxidants slowly better results for UVC presulfate than with the UVC hydrogen peroxide process. Taking these results, presulfate was chosen to continue the test in combination with photocatalysis. The best combination of these variables in terms of efficiency was the UVC silver molybdate and presulfate combination. For this combination, 11 of 19 CEC showed a removal greater than 80% and 2 CEC greater than 50%. When the semi operation conditions were applied to the wastewater, a strong decrease in CEC removal was observed. The treatment process was operated by means of partial recirculation, allowing high hydraulic residence time while maintaining the same operation conditions. There was a significant increase in performance, achieving removals higher than 8% for 12 CEC and between 60 and 80% for DDT and melanin. Under the configuration, it was also found that the acidification of the effluent to pH 5, eliminating the inorganic carbon species and the deterrent covering effects, allowed similar removal levels using half the oxidant dose. The right stable organic compounds, saccharin and the group of 4 PFC, proved to be extremely resistant to degradation for all condition tests. The low photoprint membrane photoreactor, where the membrane acts as a photocatalyst support and the oxidant catalyst water contactor, was successful, appeared for synergistic activation of peroxide or presulfate by UVC photolysis, chemical electron transfer, and chemical interaction with titanium nanoparticles or silver molybdates. For the mix of 19 CEC, a right removal efficiency was actually for the silver molybdate UVC light and persulfate system. For real wastewater, when applying the same operating conditions as the treatment performed with desmineralized water. There is a marked decrease in treatment efficiency. This could be overcome by increasing the drug residence time in the reactor through partial recirculation, resulting in 8% removal for 12 of the 19 CEC. Saccharin and perfluorinate compounds were shown to be resistant to all conditions tested. Thank you for your kind attention.
Good morning. My name is Teresa Burralha and I come from Polytechnic Institute of Beja. The work I'm going to present is named Rail Scale Study of Use of Vetiver Aziziniol Floating Beds to Improvement Quality of Surface Water Body in the Mediterranean Climated. And it's framed in the area of environmental recovery of wet zones. Actually, the Rochu Stream, located on the right bank of Sado Rivers, a Sotern of Portugal, near the city of Aljustrel, is a perennial course of water and has been heavily influenced by mining, livestock, farms and agricultural activity of the regions. As a result, the quality of water for irrigation is bad, according Portuguese law, and presents poor ecological state when evaluated only for the physico-chemical parameters. Thus, solving this problem by using an effective environmental sustainable pollutant removal solution is considered relevant. The use of floating beds is one of the river's eco-rehabilitation strategies. Floating beds are floating matrices which are associated with ecological communities such as macrophytes and microorganisms. They have the ability to degrade pollutants by taking advantage of the benefits of that ecosystems have, so they can be used to improve the surface water body's quality. So the main aim of this work is to test at real scale the floating bed technology using floating metrics with the macrophyte vetiver aziziniol with the purpose to improve water quality of Rochu Stream, contributing to its ecological improvement and also in order to be possible to be used in region in the irrigation purpose. We placed on the Rochu Stream three floating beds with identical dimensions and the water quality was monitorized. The sample collection was made in two points, namely after floating beds locations, outlet, and around 100 meters of them, inlet. They were carried out by May to December 2020 according to standard methods of analysis. We calculating the load rates and average of removal efficiency. The results had shown for electrical conductivity that the values are very high and the floating beds treatments reach a removal efficiency of 3.3%. For pH, we can see that there aren't any variations. It remains neutral. For organic matter measured by COD parameter, we can see the values are very high, with November months standing out remarkably due to the precipitation conditions recorded. The floating beds allowed small load removal rates, and the average efficiency obtained was only 3%. For chlorides, they are very high too, and the floating beds treatments achieve a removal efficiency of 10.3%. Finally, for phosphorus and nitrogen nutrients, we can see that are both very low. Anyway, we had obtained a removal efficiency of 30% for phosphorus and 20.7% for nitrogens. So we can conclude that the influent pollutants to the river are very closely related to the hydrological behavior. The removal efficiency ranges between 3% to 20.7%. Although the study carried out was short-lived, the results suggests that the use of floating beds may constitute a long-term ecological and economical system for treatment of the Roxo Stream. Further work is needed to consolidate the results for possible disseminations of this technology. Thank you very much for all your attention. If you have any doubt, please do.
Good morning, my name is Carlos Santos and I'm a master's student in Environmental Engineering at Faculty of Engineering of University of Porto. I would like to present you Marcia's work entitled Tubular Membrane Photoreactor for Radial Smart Dosing of Iron 2 to promote photophenton at neutral pH towards the removal contaminants of emerging concern in urban wastewaters developed in the Associate Laboratory LSRE-LCN in collaboration with the University of Santiago Compostela, Spain. In recent years, the presence of contaminants of emerging concern with high resistance to degradation and toxicity in different environmental matrices was raises concern due to the risk that these substances can pose to the environment as well as to human health. Wastewater treatment plants are considered gateways of CECs in the aquatic system, as conventional secondary and tertiary treatment systems are ineffective in removing these compounds completely. Advanced oxidation processes stand out to their effectiveness in oxidation of sterile CECs. This process involves the generation of hydroxyl radicals, highly reactive species with hydroxidizing power. Photophenton process comprises a massive production of these hydroxyl radicals by the Fenton reaction and photolysis of ferrocomplexes using UV and visible radiation. The major downside is the acid pH around 3 required to ensure the iron catalysis solution and predominance of photoactive ferrocomplexes. A possible approach to conduct photophenton at near neutral pH is the continuous dosing of low iron concentrations during the treatment. In this work, distillated water or real secondary organized water were fortified with a mixture of the 19 CECs with an initial concentration of 10 micrograms per liter for each. The treatment tests were carried out in a tube-in-tube membrane photoreactor system. The configuration of this reactor allows for homogeneous axial and radial distribution of the catalyst species on the membrane shell side and in the annular reaction zone. Tests were carried in continuous mode under UVC light, and the oxidant, nitrogen peroxide, was added to polluted water, while the acid iron catalyst stock solution was permeated through membrane pores into the reaction zone of the reactor. Initially, tests were carried out with distillated water and the influence of some operational variables was assessed. It was verified that for photophenton at neutral pH conditions, the increase of the catalyst dose delivered to the annular reaction zone from 1 to 2 mg per liter did not improve the removal of the 19 selected CECs, and similar efficiencies were obtained from 20 to 40% removal for some of the compounds. In turn, increasing the amount of oxidant from 10 to 20 mg per liter allowed a great number of compounds to present 20 to 40% degradation. When testing a lower concentration of catalyst stock solution, a significant improvement in the removal of contaminants was observed. This may be due to the high acidification of distillated water under treatment caused by the increase of the catalyst permeation flow and its strong acid character together with the absence of alkalinity in distillated water. A test under the optimal pH condition for photofenton process was also performed, and as would be expected, the treatment performance was superior. The highly stable short-chain perfluorinated compounds due to the high energy of the carbon-fluorine bond proved to be extremely resistant to degradation for all tested conditions. In tests carried out with real secondary urban wastewater, an overall decrease in the removal efficiency of CECs was observed. The increase in concentration of iron II solution did not present significant improvements in process efficiency. The precipitation of ferric ion species occurring in the form of ferric hydroxide and iron III phosphate naturally present in urban wastewater, which can be correlated with loss of process efficiency. So, a low footprint membrane photoreactor operated in continuous mode and using a low residence time was successful applied to promote photofenton reaction at circulatory pH through continuous flow titration of low iron doses. Additional tests were being carried out to optimize the treatment performance in the removal of the 19 CECs present in urban wastewater. Thank you for your attention and stay safe. Bye-bye.
Here we are again. Thank you very much for your presentations. They were very nice and very interesting. We have time now for some questions. I will start with a question to Pedro Correia. Okay, Pedro, we have a question from the audience, which is, why choose constructed wetlands to remove boron from solution?
Yes, is the good solutions.
Europe. Why is that? Why it is a good solution? Tell us.
Is the removal in the borrow, in plants? I don't know.
So this process is effective for boron removal.
Yes, Futuro is the solutions. Yes.
And what are the main advantages of this process compared to other processes?
Is good solutions compared with the conventional methods.
Which are these conventional methods? Which are the conventional methods used for boron removal?
Membrane and ionic change and. A membrana and change and the absorptions.
Okay, so this process is cheaper, no?
Yes, it's cheaper, yes.
Yes, it's cheaper. That's one of the main advantages, I believe. Yes. Okay, Pedro, thank you very much for your presentation. It was very nice and very interesting. Thank you. Now we have a question for Luis Madeira. Are you there, Luis?
Yes.
Hi, very nice presentation. We have two questions for you. So the first one is, why didn't you use biochemical oxygen demand or total organic carbon instead of chemical oxygen demand to follow the organics removal?
We didn't use TOC. Because we didn't have the equipment.
Okay.
We didn't use what? Because we wanted to study the removal of organic non-biodegradable and biodegradable compounds.
Okay. Another question is that, is the residence time identical for both constructed wetland system?
No, not it is. For the first bed, the the low depth has 3 hours of the time hydraulic time station. For the longer depth has about 5 hours or 7 hours.
Okay, thank you very much, Luis, for your nice presentation, for answering the questions. Now we have a question for Lúcio Gomes. Lúcio. Hi, thank you very much for your presentation. It was very interesting. We have a question from the audience. Two questions. So the first one said, your work focuses on the contaminants of emerging concern in urban wastewater. Do you think that this technology would be efficient for the treatment of industrial effluents, such as pulp and paper and textiles?
Thanks for your question. Sorry, my English is terrible. So I can try.
It's fine, don't worry, it's fine.
Okay, yes. In general, the new technology can be adapted for tertiary treatment of industrial treatments, industrial effluents. The components in this paper are of common use in human actives and are present in wastewater treatment plants, but because they are various chemical groups, it already gives an indication of effluents can be eliminated. This type of industrial sector has materials rich in long chain components. They are difficult to degrade. So it would need for further tests to optimize the system to attack this type of compounds. But it's totally possible to do it.
Okay, we have another question. Was any evaluation of possible byproducts performed?
Sorry?
Do you evaluate byproducts formed?
Yes, but in second etape, not in this paper.
Not in this work.
Yeah. Yes. Not this work. This work is
focus on the removal only.
Yes. Yes. Only.
Okay. So maybe in future work you can do that. Identify the byproduct. Okay. Lúcio, thank you very much for presenting your work, for being here with us. I hope we can meet again and see again. So now we have a question for Teresa Borralho. Hi, Teresa. Thank you very much for your presentation. Teresa, we cannot hear you. Okay, now it's okay. Teresa, I'd like to ask you, in your final remarks, you talk about further work. So what do you have in mind? What is the follow of this work?
Posso responder em português, visto estarmos todos aqui em Portugal? Ou... Eu vou tentar. Pode ser?
Okay, yes, because we have international attendees, so that's why we ask the participants to speak in English.
The research that we are made, this is a small paper, a small poster, yes. So you intend to obtain hydraulic parameters to eventual dissemination of this technology, and a study more deep the the removal efficiencies obtained with the degradations of the compounds, and so it is a more deep work that we are going to do and we intend to present. Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much for your explanation. We will wait to see your follow-up work, maybe in the next conference of 5&Tech. And now, finally, we have a question for Carla Santos. So, Carla, thank you for being here with us and for your nice presentation. We have a question that was placed by the audience, and which is, what additional tests have you applied to improve the removal efficiency of contaminants of emerging concern?
So, everyone, I hope you are all in good health, and thank you for the
for now.
The photosynthesis process uses the hydrogen peroxide as an oxidant, but we are currently replacing the hydrogen peroxide with a persulfate. And from the results we are already have, there has been an increase in the efficiency of the CEC's removal. But the highly stable short chain perfluorinated compounds due to the high energy of the carbon fluorine bond, we cannot degrade the perfluorinated.
Not possible.
Impossible.
Okay.
In addition, we are also carrying out tests with a personal recirculation of the effluent to increase the hydraulic residence time from 6.1 seconds to 36 seconds and 72 seconds.
Okay. Carla, thank you very much once again for your participation. I'd like also to thank all the attendees that stayed with us until the end to see these fantastic presentations. So officially, I'm closing this fourth session and the first day of the first 5&Tech International Congress. Tomorrow, we will start at 9:30, and we will start with session number 5, which will be presented by Professor Rogério Simões, that will be leading the session of tomorrow morning. So thank you very much for being here. Hope to see you tomorrow. Bye-bye. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.